It's recording now.
Unfortunate. What are we talk about?
No, let's just talk shit. Sounds we always good. Talk shit.
Yeah, that'd be normal.
I don't have a piece of paper
anymore. You don't have a piece of... Oh, shit, he's out of pieces of paper. What's he going to write on?
Ladies and gentlemen, I am your host, Double Tap, and this is Aussie Game Rants. This week, we do or do not. There is no try. Of course, as always, I'm joined by my partners in crime, Shoxy23, say hi.
Hey, how's it going?
Jimmy D, Rebel War Alliance. So, this week, we're podcast reviewing the beta of Star Wars Battlefront. Now, of course, we played it on PS4, but it's out on everything. It's out on Xbox One, surprisingly, running at 720p, and it's out on PC, which is fantastic. Now, it came out on the 8th of October for everyone, and a little bit earlier for other people with early access. Let's go around and give first impressions. What do you think, Jimmy D?
I loved the original Battlefront series. It was probably one of the best Star Wars games to date. Particularly Battlefront 2. So this one is quite a homage to the originals. Being made by DICE, it is a very Battlefield feel. So it does have a bit more explosions, etc. Very Michael Bay. But it essentially is Battlefront. If you look back at the original Battlefront, there are a lot of similarities. This one, on the other hand, does have some kind of aerial combat where the original did not. So they have kind of built on it, but being a reboot, they haven't got the space battles or anything like that to the extent of what they do in Battlefront 2 in the original series. So, I mean, it's a building block. It's a new engine and everything like that. These guys have done quite well with what they have. Their scenery and everything like that looks amazing. So they have...
Beautiful.
They've
done their work on that really
they've
well.
Definitely done a lot of homework. I mean, if you watched any of their things on YouTube when they were developing this, they actually went to the sites where the original Star Wars films were made and took pictures and all that stuff so that they could get like this true feel of what it looked like. So they've done really well with their research, sounds and everything make it sound almost like you're in
a
movie.
The sound's the best part for me. I was playing it with my headphones on and just hearing the explosions go off in the right, hearing a thermal detonator go off in the front left and being shot at, you really feel like you're in that immersive battle experience, especially on Hoth. I found that was definitely, you know, 20 versus 20. It was a massive event. And then talking about the beauty of the game and the scenery that they've put in, you're running through the trenches on Hoth and you look at the snow and it's glistening and it's got that really nice texture to it.
You put your footprints in it and everything like that. It's just, it's aesthetically, it's a very well thought out game.
And when you shoot the snow and everything, it puffs up and like a wood and everything. It looks good.
Yeah.
Very nice.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
So what are your first impressions, Shoxy?
This is basically my first proper Star Wars game. The only other ones I've really played have been the Lego games and Pod Racer back on the Nintendo 64. So it's...
Good old Pod Racer.
Been a while. I'm really surprised with how good it is, how easy it is to jump straight into it. I haven't played much Battlefield before, so I'm not really familiar with this type of game, but I jumped into it straight away and I could get it, and it was good. It was good.
Yep.
I found that for something that's not focused on the Jedi or the Sith, they've done it really well, considering that this is more about the troopers and the rebels.
It's definitely an interesting perspective. I mean, most games, you look at the Force Unleashed and Force Unleashed 2, they were Jedi-centric. And I mean, I guess everyone wants to play as the hero in these kind of games.
They have added that in this, though, with their like hero cards and stuff like that. You pick up these little power-ups and then you can essentially become, until you die, Luke Skywalker, Darth Vader, and then other ones that'll be released with the main game.
What are your feelings on those power-ups, though? Because you can get a whole variety. You can get hero ones, obviously, for in the beta, Luke Skywalker and Darth Vader. And then you can get machinery power-ups, being your aeroplanes and your AT-ATs, AT-STs. And then you can also get basic ones, being guns and shields and that kind of thing. How do you feel about them being in the game, rather than, obviously, in Battlefield, where you'd have your tanks sitting by the start of the match, you'd jump in with five men and you'd tear off down the track.
Mm. It's early stages, so I can't really say whether it's going to be like that with the rest of the game. Like, there could be parts in, I can't remember the one of the areas, but with the speeders and stuff, who knows, we might be able to just jump on a speeder.
Being a smaller vehicle,
you might be able to just go and zoom off. Yeah. So, I don't mind them. I do understand why they've got them for the aerial combat, because you don't want too many people just jumping into aeroplanes or waiting at the docks, waiting for one, which was a problem that Battlefield had. A lot of people would just sit there and
they wouldn't participate until they came. Either
they'd be waiting there for the plane, or you'd have another person on the opposite team just basically waiting for those things to respawn, then bang, blow it up. So I do understand why they've done it as cards or power-ups. I think they call them cards in this game.
Yeah, I think so, yeah. They're power-ups, but yeah, basically cards. They remind me of, actually, the icons remind me of Tarzos. I feel like I'm collecting Tarzos again.
Mm.
And obviously the hero ones are the super rare ones, which I haven't bloody well had yet.
No.
So.
Shogsy was very fortunate to get that.
It's unfortunate, though, everyone targets you when you're the hero.
Oh, yeah. I mean, straight away I had about six or seven people shooting at me. I got the card to become Luke Skywalker, and all of a sudden everybody's trying to kill me. I managed to get a few kills with it and everything, but then someone's walked along with an AT-ST and blew the crap out of me.
Considering that they are, like, the hero cards, they're the best of the best that on this game, it's reasonably balanced for, you know, focus fire or something like that. Like, one-on-one, you can't defeat him.
Yeah.
There's no way that you'd be able to do it. But if you've got, like, three or four of you circling him, so that balance is there. You still feel powerful as hell as this hero, but at the same time, there's still that vulnerability for the opposition.
Mm. Yeah.
I found that, just a small side note, that the character models for Darth Vader is gorgeous. They've obviously put a lot of love into that. But for Luke Skywalker, it felt like a gimp.
Yeah, he's very... they used the Return of the Jedi, I think it was. The Return of the Jedi Luke Skywalker, which is the older, more mature version. But
even the shading on it is disgusting.
His facial features and stuff like that, he does look very porcelain.
Yeah.
Whereas it looks like, because Darth Vader is Darth Vader...
you can easily animate...
It doesn't matter who's watched Star Wars, everyone remembers Darth Vader. They took a lot of effort into him, and because he's basically the poster child for this, I'm sure later on, if we come up against, say, you can pick up a hero card of Yoda.
Oh.
I'm not sure whose heroes they
Yoda
are.
Yoda and General Grievous, but I reckon, my God.
Yes.
But unfortunately, this one's only on the last three. I mean, things like that. Boba Fett should look actually quite nice because he doesn't have facial features.
Yep.
Anything with, like, a kind of a helmet, I reckon they might have done quite well with, say...
Because you don't have to replicate a face. Mm. It's very hard.
Smooth surface.
I think the one that they might struggle with would have to be, like, Chewbacca.
Yeah, Chewie might be a bit difficult.
Is Chewie going to be
just because of the hair features? They had him in Battlefront 2, and they did quite well for the graphics of that day. I'm pretty sure he might be in one of the levels, one of the jungle levels.
That would make sense.
I think, and then they've got, like, Han Solo. All of those ones are going to kind of look very porcelain because they didn't focus so much on that kind of look. It does look gorgeous, but they are very static porcelain faces.
Yeah, yeah.
But the question is, did he shoot first?
He did.
Of course he did.
Now, in saying that, so I really want to highlight in this, it is a beta, but it's a beta where the game is a month out. The implications of this are quite ridiculous, in my opinion. It's not so much a beta as a glorified demo to see whether or not the servers can hold the overloading.
It's basically them trying to stress test it.
Yeah.
Which, to be honest, everyone who's done this to stress test and done a, you know, in quotation marks, beta, I think it was Secret World, Guild Wars, all these kind of MMO-esque kind of games, even Call of Duty, with their Black Ops 2 betas and all that stuff.
Black Ops 3,
sorry,
Black Ops
my bad.
3, yeah, I had a little bit of go on that one as well.
But,
yeah,
like, all of those things are just basically server stress tests.
Yeah.
Problem is a lot of people do not go and download these betas. They will just go get the game. The stress tests don't truly mimic what people will get. If you look at, like, say...
30-40%
A good one would have to be... I think Diablo 3 had a beta at one point on the PC. And that worked fine. And then as soon as that game released... all hell broke loose. You couldn't get onto the servers because the servers broke.
It's true. In saying that, though, my opinion is of the Star Wars one, I've seen a vast variety of different players on there. I've got heaps of friends who have actually accessed it, and I find that it's going to be heavily accessed. But the thing is, it actually comes out on November the 11th.
Yes, they're going to have a lot of problems with competing against another major title.
Let's be honest. And I don't know anyone who's picking up Battlefield.
Front.
Battlefront. I know heaps and heaps of people who are picking up 4x4 on day one. Shogsy being one.
I'll be
Jimmy
there.
D being another.
Yeah.
And I've got other friends that are doing it as well. I just don't think Star Wars, at least this game, is going to get the market that it thinks it's going for.
The initial release market, anyways. It might get some later on. Like, I'm planning to get it later on once the servers have kind of dropped a little.
But with an online-only game, because obviously, let's face it, it's got a offline mode, but it doesn't have a bloody campaign, which is another issue.
There's no campaign.
No, it's mission-based, basically exactly the same as what you're doing there, just with AIs.
And with an online-only game, we've seen this happen before, Evolve, you pick it up a few months after, there's no one playing. Titanfall, you pick it up a few months after, there's no one playing. Thankfully, with things like Battlefield and COD, they already have their market. Now,
They've already established their markets.
Whereas this game, being Star Wars, yeah, great, fantastic. Being Battlefield...
Front. Fuck, you've done that again, man.
I told you. Being Battlefront, it's not going to have that market.
Yeah.
It's not going to have that share.
I think the only saving factor for it is...
Star Wars.
Star Wars for one, and the company who's making it. So a lot of people who play Battlefield will go and play this one.
Yeah.
A lot of people who play this one will basically come from the Battlefield franchise people.
Yeah.
That's kind of its bit of a saving grace. But then you've got it's a hard thing to do when you've got such a prolific single player releasing the night before.
People are going to sink hundreds and hundreds of hours into that. If I buy a multiplayer online game, the only time I'm really going to play it is when I'm with my friends. I don't play them alone. I find them quite boring and tedious.
Yeah, it's a problem with a lot of onlines. MMOs suffer from the same kind of fate.
Yeah.
WoW is World of Warcraft is the exception.
Yeah.
There are a lot of people who play. But then at the same time, those people develop friendships on that game.
There's not a lot of scope for that on this.
No. This is basically, you go in, it feels to me it's going to be one of those games that'll sit there for a while, you'll pick it up, play a few games, and then it'll sit there for a while again, because it's basically, I feel like playing multiplayer. I don't feel like playing COD. I'm going to play a bit of Star Wars. And that's where, I think Battlefront, basically the original Battlefronts had the same thing. They had the same problem where it's a great game. The problem that it had was that it was a game that people would pick up every now and then.
Well, see, I know a few people who play Battlefield, and I know that they play that game almost exclusively. So Battlefield has a really well-established market, but I can't see them coming over to this.
No.
They went over, some of them went over to Hardline, admittedly, and they said, yeah, it was good, but then they immediately bounced back to Battlefield. So I can see them doing the same thing here and getting some of that original market, but I think after 2 or 3 months, start of the new year...
They go back to what they're familiar with and...
And there's going to be no one online.
The thing is, the people who play Battlefield and COD, they're the ones who like that war genre, and specifically realistic war. You have a look at when they went to... Well, I should say modern day war. If you have a look at when Call of Duty went from Modern Warfare down to World at War.
Yeah.
A lot of people still play Modern Warfare. Yeah, a lot of people played Modern Warfare more.
I was one like that. I bought Modern Warfare 1. I was like, this is great. And they released World at War. And I saw a bit of it and I was like, why would I want to go back to another World War 2 shooter?
It came down to... you had Medal of Honor and stuff like that. They were the ones that were basically the old school World War 2 shooters. You had them, Wolfenstein, anything like that. They're the ones that you think of as the old styles.
Yep.
If you look at Medal of Honor, you think, that's World War 1, World War 2 shooters. You look at Call of Duty, you're looking at more like the, you know, the Iraqi wars, the war in Afghanistan, all those kind of things is what you would associate with Battlefield and those. And that's the problem that Hardline had, was that Hardline was more of a cops versus robbers thing, which was already done by Payday.
Yeah, and done very well by Payday with a very loyal fan base.
So I find
it's going to be hard for it to find its niche.
You're going to have its Star Wars fan base, but you're going to have a lot of people still sitting there going, well, those people who want to play that Star Wars fan base, they want to be the Jedi.
Mm.
They don't want to play as the war. They want to be the one who runs around and, you know, fuck shit up.
Yeah. They'll go and play Force Unleashed.
Yeah, exactly. Well, they'll go play those.
I don't think they play that.
No. But they'll go play something like that, or they'll go play, you know, the Old Republic, which go into that one.
Yeah.
But, like, they'll go play something where you play as a Jedi. Yeah. There's a lot of people actually do who have that Star Wars fan base will go back to the old, you know, Jedi Outcasts and Jedi Academies from the PS2/Xbox era.
Yeah. I find that this one, for me, and I hate saying it, it feels exactly like a Battlefield ripoff or a Battlefield clone. Yeah. And to me, I've heard a lot of discussion on various news sites about this game being simplified to obviously target an audience that isn't the Battlefield audience. It's going to be the Star Wars audience who haven't entered into the shooter or FPS kind of game before. And I can kind of see that with the controls and the guns and the layouts and that kind of thing. And I can appreciate it to a certain extent. But I think because it is so deeply aligned with Battlefield, that the people who are experienced are going to 100%, no matter what you do, tear the field apart. I've already seen that. I've experienced it multiple times, especially on Hoth, where you are the rebels.
Mm.
You stand out because you're all in brown, and then you've got your opposition who are all in white, and it's very hard to see.
Yeah. I played a game on Hoth before you guys got here, and I was playing, and on the rebels, the other one,
the imperial
team.
So we've established that I'm the Star Wars nerd out of the group.
Apparently. So there was someone on the Imperial team. Their second best player had 9 kills. Their best player had 47.
Yeah, I had a similar situation.
Yeah.
I was on Rebel, and my top player, I think, had 11. And then on the opposition, they had 59.
Yeah.
It's just a demolition. And I was watching, I think it was an IGN review of the beta, and they were saying that these are the tips, you know, XYZ that you need on Hoth playing as the Rebels to win, but you're probably not going to win.
Yeah.
That's the bottom line. I think the balancing is a little bit off.
At the
start, and obviously, yes, it's a beta. In my opinion, it's not bloody beta. It's the
basically a finished product, but you can see there are going to be balancing problems on certain maps. The smaller map, not so much, because
really
that is very close quarters.
Yeah, that's very close quarters combat.
COD,
which for my money, I prefer COD for a squad based shooter. You know, you get 5-6 people and you're a nice tight unit. You can converse, you can strategize.
Nice small game, you can work out what you're doing.
On your 6, on your 12, you can you know, throw those instructions out, grenade coming in, that kind of thing. It's a lot faster paced.
Yep.
Whereas Battlefield and obviously Hoth, you've got that large scale war, which is nice atmospherically, but for my gameplay, it's not what I'm
You can't
prefer.
Go, oh, this guy's over here, and you're just like, okay, I'm on the other side of the field. It's not my problem.
So I tend to disagree with that one. Just purely, they are very different games.
They are very different
Your Battlefield is more of, like, a tactical one. You've got more of, like, you know, you can actually have a sniper stationed at one area who can shoot across that map.
I'd agree. Yeah.
These people are the ones who know, you know, trajectories and wind paths and all this stuff, so they're the ones that you have them do that. You'll have the other people in your inventories, and then you have the other people who go close quarters with their shotguns and stuff.
You get the balance. If you've got 20v20, you're not going to get that balance unless you know everyone.
Yeah.
And if you do, there's going to be some assumed roles. But I find that there's quite often, if you're not talking to people, there's quite often a conflict. Well, I want to do that role. But I want to do that role.
Yeah.
I don't know how to do anything else.
Yeah.
You know, there is that kind of thing, which I haven't seen yet in this beta. I haven't seen that kind of role layout. I've just seen warfare.
Well, that's the other thing too. Their weapon choice, though, they are keeping very close to the Star Wars you know, mythology, games, mythos, and everything like that. So they're keeping, like, their E11 blasters, all that kind of stuff, do look exactly like the ones that they're supposed to.
Yeah.
The problem is your sniper rifles, they're a player card. Mm. There's no real diversity between classes. You don't have this, you know, okay, this person's playing a heavy infantry person, this one's playing a sniper. They had that in Battlefront 2.
Yep.
You could play as the heavy, you could play as just the normal guy who runs around with the machine gun, who has the sniper. So they had all this kind of stuff. This one doesn't. At this point, from what I've seen, this one doesn't seem to have that kind of thing to it. Just because, like, it's one of those things where, basically, from what I've seen, especially in Hoth, where it's such a large area, and you could have the snipers, you could have the heavies, everything like that. Yeah. At the moment, in this beta, all we see is people running around with a faster machine gun, a slower machine gun, or a really powerful machine gun.
Of course, it is a beta.
You've only got the four guns, then there's not a massive difference between them.
No, they're basically the same. Mm. Well-balanced, but the same. And if that carries over to the actual game, I could see that being one of the problems to differentiate it.
There'll be more variety, I'm sure. I have a lot of confidence.
Yeah.
But if they don't get that balance right, then...
Yeah,
I'd basically write the game off, and it's a very hard line to walk because there's been all this acclaim and you know legend around this game. Yeah, it's coming out. Here's a trailer. Well, we're not showing you much. Here's a beta. Go play it. We're not giving you too much. Great. Let me see the finished product. Let me figure out what's going on and show me what you've got. Because at this point, it's so, even with the beta release, we've played it, it's so hard to predict what's going to be in the final package.
Yeah, exactly. Like, at the moment, we're sitting there going, I don't know how this is going to go. I do like it, but I could see myself playing this for 15 minutes and putting it down.
If I get my hands on a beta, what I want you to do is exactly the same thing when I go to YouTube and I want to find a trailer. I want you in the first 15 seconds, if it's a beta, 5 minutes, to grab my attention and go, you need to buy this game. You, right there, need to buy this game. Yep. This one said, you could buy this game. Before that's coming out the day before, you could also buy that game.
And you've already got Battlefield, so, you know.
And I've got Call of Duty.
I found, like, their trailers were all, like, cinematic. There was no real gameplay.
Yep.
Their gameplay trailers were basically, you know, 5-second snippets of some kind of action that was going on in
the
game.
Mostly the heroes, which they didn't tell us at that point, were going to be tokens.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's not grabbing my attention, like, say, Fallout got my attention purely because it's Fallout. I've got to admit that. But, you know, this one being a new IP, basically, or a revamp on an old IP, needed to grab my attention, especially being Star Wars. And a lot of people
competing in the Christmas time frame.
You know, Christmas time frame, you've got Star Wars people are very finicky about what goes on in their lore.
Yeah, you got to have that continuity of all the
story. Okay,
now
we're talking lore. Luke Skywalker on Hoth. I know you've mentioned it before, but come on!
Yeah, the only time that you actually see him on Hoth is he's basically still the, you could say, the Padawan.
To cut open at least.
Yeah, he's the blue lightsaber, you know, scaredy cat.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
Still at this point, he's not this, you know, hero that he is in Return of the Jedi, which is what they used. I can understand why they used him. Same time, it's not fitting with the lore.
Because a developer came out and said in an interview they used this version of Luke Skywalker because they wanted that more mature hero that fits in with that whole hero card system, which I understand, but at the same time, if you're a Star Wars buff and you love your lore and you're playing this game because you haven't played any other FPS shooters, you're gonna still be pissed off.
Yeah.
But if you've played first-person shooters and you're, you know, cool, I like the Star Wars universe, you're going to be pissed off. Because it doesn't quite hit the FPS market either. It's kind of that middle ground where...
It's a bit of everything mashed together and it almost
It's
going to
capture
works.
All 13-year-olds before the new movie comes out, let's be honest.
That's basically what I think they're trying to do with the time frame. Like I said, they're very finicky about what goes on. Although, on the bright side of this one coming out, it opens up the floodgates for more. If no one knew, LucasArts sold and they went to Disney, and that's why we've got like games like Disney Infinity 3 and stuff, which aren't for the hardcore Star Wars fans.
Are you sure?
Well, when they did it, Well, yeah, okay, cool. I probably will get the statues.
I'll be buying the statues. Give me a Yoda.
I won't get the game. I won't get the game.
Yeah, forget
the game.
The statues. They're toys. I want them collectibles, man.
Yeah.
That's what I'm about.
But, like,
stay tuned for unboxings.
It does open up the floodgates for other ones to come out, and ones that people were really excited for, such as when LucasArts announced that they were doing a Star Wars 1313, I think it was called.
Oh my god, when that came out.
The cover-based shooter one that they were doing, it was basically you played as a bounty hunter.
It was Uncharted,
In
Star Wars universe. Which, I lost my shit, and that game got canned.
Yeah, and it got canned once it got sold. This being done by DICE and all that stuff, it opens up the floodgates for people. As long as this gets a decent amount of sales,
people might originally turn around and go,
maybe 1313 might have been a great idea.
Hopefully, you know what I mean?
We might actually see a decent Old Republic released by Bethesda.
That'd be good.
Oh god.
Yeah, and not an MMO that crashed horribly.
Mm.
Horribly.
Mm.
Yeah. Something you can really sink your teeth into.
A proper like Dragon Age-esque kind of
big open world and
very
story based.
That's what it was like. It was basically Dragon Age in the Star Wars universe.
It'd be Mass Effect then basically.
Yeah, basically. But I do not have a problem with them doing that. Sorry, Bethesda did not make it. It was BioWare, bad.
Yeah.
People are gonna kill me for that one. Ooh, I feel bad for doing that. But yeah, so it's just one of those things that when that came out, it was a great game. It was very heavily story-based. And this is what this opens up the floodgates for, providing that this gets enough sales. Problem is, I don't know whether they're going to get enough sales, because EA owns both BioWare and DICE.
Yeah.
And EA is very, very money-hungry. Anyone knows that.
Yeah.
You can tell that this one was rushed as well. Typical EA thing. They rush everything.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, you could see where they wanted to go with it. But it's one of those things that we need to have like a middle ground. It's not,
yeah,
yep.
It's not what it should have been
at this
point,
but
it's definitely a step in the right direction.
Yeah. And we're talking that it shouldn't be, obviously, because it is only a beta, but a month left, it's basically a finished product. So a couple of things before we wrap it up. Let's talk about the multiplayer quickly. Obviously, you can join parties and you start off in the field, and then your partner, which you do get a partner, not multiple partners.
You don't have a squad.
You don't have a squad. They can start with you or behind you. If you die and they're still alive, they can start with you. I thought that was a brilliant idea.
Yeah, I liked that little thing, because when you play with friends, and especially in something that's got such a large map,
you can't always go, where the hell are they?
You're not looking for them. It means that you're constantly able to play together.
It's a good addition
for friends.
Well, it's great. In saying that, though, my experiences so far have been, I was spawned with my friend, and I'm dead because someone was killing him.
Yes.
Sometimes, strategically, it's better to spawn alone. But I found the multiplayer generally quite well. The matchmaking was acceptable.
Yep.
Yeah,
not fantastic.
I found the matchmaking to be very quick.
Yeah, it was
great. It was
compared to a lot of them. I mean, I wasn't sitting there for, 10 minutes at a time, or even with the new Metal Gear Online, there was no cutouts, even though it's in beta phase.
Mm.
I haven't had a cutout where I've just been kicked from a game, which is a good thing. It's very simplified compared to the Battlefield franchise, and I feel like anyone who plays a shooter, that might be its downfall.
Yeah. All right, so let's talk mechs and mechanics. I think they're a big part of this game. Obviously, that includes space warfare. Now, a lot of fans have been really pissed off because there isn't what we'd call a classic dog fighting system. There's not a classic space fighting system, but there are planes. There's a large variety of those planes.
There actually is a level that you can play a space battle. It's just not to the extent of what they had in Battlefront 2, where you had the two bases, you picked up your planes, you dog fought, or you went into the other base, you could blow up their ship from the inside or out.
Which is what a lot of people wanted
for this
game. They
wanted that space battle, not what they're giving them, where it's just a dog fight and you just pick different aeroplanes before you spawn. You basically wanted to be able to pick your player, and then you could pick your aeroplane, whichever way you wanted it to do.
Yep.
And it was really good that you could do from the inside or out. It opened up tactical advantages. You could have people trying to do outside while someone's trying to infiltrate the inside. Mm. It was a really good concept for a space battle. they didn't use that in this one. And that's what people started to get really angry about.
What about the AT-ATs and AT-STs? I found, from my experience, that they're quite overpowered.
Mm. Yeah, it takes a lot to take even the little ones down. So
yeah, the
AT-ATs are pretty good. I mean,
they're powerful.
They've always been shown as basically a walking tank. That's they are supposed to be huge. But if you watch, right next to the legs,
oh my god.
Yeah, they're massive. They are really to scale of what they should be.
Yeah.
And they are. They're basically walking tanks or, you know, walking air carriers is the best way to explain it. Massive, massive machines and basically impenetrable. I did not like the fact that they didn't use the, I can't remember what they're called now, the snow speeders or something like that, to basically wrap the legs.
Yeah, you can't put the cable out and
can.
Just...
Yes.
You can.
Yeah.
None of us here have had the opportunity to, because there's a certain window of which you can do it, and not only that, it's a quick time event.
Oh.
Yeah, a quick time event.
Yeah.
So what happens is you're flying and you go right next to an AT-AT, and then you push I think L1 and R1, and then you lock on, and then you move your stick in a little black bar up and down, and then the little black bar pushes you forward, and you have to stay inside. And then you have to stay inside some more, and you have to stay inside some more, and eventually the AT-AT falls down if you're successful. If you're not close to a cliff, in which case the computer decides that you've hit the cliff.
Fly into a cliff.
I want to just fly the damn plane. Let me fly around the legs. It's not hard to go in circles, people.
Yeah, exactly. That's the thing.
That's the easiest part about flying the plane.
They did it easily in Battlefront 2. Why couldn't they do that in this? I can't stand quick time events.
Mm, I hate them.
Yeah.
When they first came out, they were revolutionary. They helped with storytelling and cutscene integration.
I've got no worries with them doing the whole immersive thing with the cutscenes.
Yep.
But to implement it into a multiplayer game is a different story.
You don't want it in general gameplay. You want its own thing.
That's simplifying gameplay too much.
Yeah, I absolutely agree. Especially for something that's meant to be capturing everyone. You know, it's really just basic. If I get in a plane, and if I get lucky enough to get, you know, hooked onto an AT-AT, let me test my skill and actually wrap its legs.
Yeah. I mean, it was skillful enough when you were in Battlefront 2. You had to be skillful enough to actually hit the legs with the magnetic strip. You also needed someone in the back to aim that magnetic strip.
Mm.
You know, they did that well in there. Why wasn't that implemented in this?
Yeah.
The way they stopped the flow of those kind of things happening in that original series was, you know, if the Imperials captured the base in which the fighters spawned, then they weren't getting fighters. So those rebels would have to capture that base back in order to get the AT-ATs. That made sense to me. This, with the quick time event, learning that it's a quick time event really annoys me.
Yep. Wait until you try it out. It's not a very fun experience. All right. So, let's review this one using our flash review scale, being bad, neutral, or good, because it is a beta, and if we're lucky enough to get our hands on it, a full copy, we'll give it a full review in a solo queue. So, Jimmy D?
I'm going to have to go neutral. I'm very on the fence with this. It seems good. The concept is great. I'm just worried about how quickly I'll get bored of it.
Mm.
Being a beta, I'm excited to play it, so I'm playing it non-stop. But once it comes out, because I've already been playing it, I'm worried that, you know, I might get a bit like, this is exactly what I did before, and put it down.
Yeah.
And then it just collects dust. I might pick it up, you know, a few months down the track and go, I'll give it a go, and then there's no one on there again.
Yeah.
So, I'd have to go neutral with a possibility of good, depending on what they do with the full release.
Shogsy.
Yeah, I'm in the same category. I'm going in neutral for it. It's it's too much of everything. You've got a bit of Battlefield there. You've got a bit of the Star Wars there, but it's not coming together quite well enough.
I like that. It doesn't really have its own identity.
Yeah,
it's derivative.
Yeah, it's a teenager that doesn't know where it's going just yet.
It's the 15-year-old girl with the black makeup on her face. Yeah, I have to give it a neutral as well.
Yeah.
It's just an unfortunate situation I think they've found themselves in. Yes, it's great. I am super hyped. And I love the music and the sound.
Oh, yeah, the sound.
Oh, my God. And the art. I find it beautiful.
And so it's got a lot of potential to be really good.
But it's got not big potential to be absolutely garbage.
I think that's the problem too, is there's so much hype surrounding it that it's going to become a disappointment for most
people. If a hype train is traveling 120 kilometers an hour and Star Wars is at the end of it, most likely there's going to be an accident. We've seen that before. Episode 1, Jabba Jar Binks.
Oh, the Republic.
Gosh, flu season. All right.
Did you say Jabba Jabba?
Jabba Jabba.
Jabba Jabba Binks.
Jabba Jabba Binks.
Holy shit.
Jar Jar Binks. So, ladies and gentlemen, thank you for listening to our review of the Star Wars Battlefront. Thank you for listening to our Battlefront review. I've been your host, Double Tap. You can find us on Facebook at Aussie Game Rants. You can find us on Twitter at Aussie Game Rants. You can even email us at AussieGameRants@gmail.com. You can find us on Instagram at Aussie Game Rants.
Thanks for joining us.
Don't forget to like and subscribe. And leave a comment down below.
See you next time.